Next, it's my pleasure to introduce Robin Conwit, who is the program officer for the course that you guys are participating in. He's going to talk about data and safety monitoring for clinical trials.
Good morning. Today we're going to talk about boards or committees that objectively evaluate clinical trials to make sure that they're conducted in an ethical and valid manner. In 1967, an external advisory board first recommended to NIH that such committees be created in order to monitor safety, efficacy, and conduct. This degree of oversight is mandated for sufficiently complex trials. That is, when the stakes are high enough. That is, all phase three studies and masked phase one, two therapeutic studies. Also, any high-risk phase one or two clinical trials. NINDS actually requires that all clinical trials involving interventions that entail, as we know, more than minimal risk to participants at DSMB. The DSMB or safety officer should ensure fidelity to trial protocols and prevent a knee-jerk reaction to noise in the data. Ongoing review ensures that the trial can continue without jeopardizing patient safety, ensures trial conducted according to the highest scientific and ethical standards, high quality, validity, and scientific integrity, and assists in determining if any of the treatment procedures should be altered or stopped. There's always some risk involved, hence the need for minimizing risk. For NINDS as the sponsor, and I'm going to talk from that perspective since that's my experience, the DSMB members report to the NIH, essentially, not to anyone else. And NINDS has their own responsibility, or our own responsibility, that is, the responsibility for oversight of data and safety monitoring to ensure that the safety and quality is in place. Monitoring is timely and effective, and those responsible have the appropriate expertise, and the Institute must be informed of recommendations that emanate from monitoring. Who is part of the DSMB membership? Well, let me say the chair of the DSMB is a key person. This should be an impartial leader balancing the opinions of the other members. There should definitely be a statistician as well as the chair who understands the statistical aspects very well. Also, at least one relevant clinician, methodologist, and sometimes an ethicist, and as we talked about the other night, more and more, it's becoming increasingly important to have a patient advocate to try to understand. NINDS actually appoints the members to the DSMB, and the voting members must have appropriate expertise in scientific and methodological areas, and we talked about the components and the independence, which is extremely important, and this is attested to the emergency. In small single-site studies, which many of you will be performing, actually a safety officer performs the monitoring in conjunction with a statistician. The safety monitor is appointed by the grantee institution, and this person reviews adverse events and serious adverse events on an ongoing basis to determine if any action is needed. For NINDS-sponsored studies that are likely to entail risk, also, an independent medical reviewer or monitor is appointed, often by the Statistical or Data Management Center, sometimes by the Clinical Coordinating Center, in order to review serious adverse events in real time. This person is often unelected. As you can see here, NINDS is the center of the universe. So the funded clinical trial is funded by NINDS. The DSMB is appointed by NINDS, the advisory to NINDS, and the liaison, who is one of the members of the Office of Clinical Research, facilitates meetings and communication. What are the DSMB activities? Well, they include focusing on performance data, patient recruitment, retention, dropout rates, safety reports, treatment monitoring, interim analyses, and so on. I would like to emphasize the confidentiality of trial data. This is the most important. And recommending to the principal investigator and NINDS whether to continue with the trial. Monitoring patient recruitment rates is a extremely important to ensure their end goals are met, and is the trial feasible? That's another question that's evaluated. The DSMB has certain authority. They can request to see all blinded and unblinded data, and can request additional reports. And as I stated before, the DSMB can actually advise the Institute to start, to stop, or modify the trial protocol and which genealogies. Roger will go into some examples. So the main difference between the open and closed session is who attends and often whether the data is seen in an aggregated or an unaggregated fashion. So in the open session, data is generally presented in an unaggregated by treatment group manner, or in the closed session, data is aggregated by treatment group. Also in the closed session, the event rate is often known. Participants, and this is often for the first meeting, participants in the first closed executive session will include the DSMB members, the NINDS DSMB liaison. Then the open session will bring in everyone, people from the coordinating center, the principal investigators, the staff from the institution, the program directors, the NINDS DSMB liaison, and the DSMB members. The closed executive session this time includes the study statisticians, and then there's a final open session where the recommendations are made. In the first meeting, usually the protocol is analyzed very, very thoroughly. The DSMB process. Again, the first meeting is usually to discuss the protocol and establish monitoring guidelines. But from that point on, there are usually biannual meetings, which can be either in person or conference call or generally one of each, in which accumulating data is reviewed. And then an interim analysis will be conducted if appropriate, but most of them are pre-specified. In addition, emergency meetings can be called by the DSMB or NINDS at any time, should patient safety issues arise. So I just wanted to make a few more points that ideally the DSMB does not modify the study protocol, although this does happen in certain circumstances. And in summary, the DSMB actually is put into place to protect human subjects, to avoid risks, and to ensure that the unavoidable risks that subjects take on result in the highest quality of treatment, safety, and efficacy. So Roger was going to present three cases that I had written up a number of years ago from the NINDS.
Sally, you're stuck. Do you want to test on? So I have the unenviable task. So what I'm going to do here is present information that Robin wrote up and published, and she runs the NINDS office of the whole trial. Thank you. Okay. All right. Same financial disclosure. So this is the article. This is published in Annals of Emergency Medicine, and it basically goes over the experience a while back that NINDS had with DSMBs or examples of DSMBs. Overseeing trials of treatments for neurologic diseases. And they illustrate the capability of DSMBs to help ensure human subject protection and improve the treatment of populations outside the trial through deciding when studies should be stopped to protect subjects, or in fact sometimes to increase the rate at which information is disseminated to the medical community to improve the care of patients outside of the study. Okay. So the first example with the carotid antiarterectomy in symptomatic patient study that enrolled patients who had a ischemic stroke, and they had a stenotic carotid lesion on the same side that they had the stroke. And they had patients divided into two different strata based on the extent of the carotid stenosis, either 30 to 69% or 70 to 99%. So this study was done, and published in the New England Journal back in 1991. And what they found was that there seemed to be a marked reduction in the incidence of stroke in the patients with a higher grade class of lesions that became apparent long before they had completed the planned follow-up for the patients. So the patients had been enrolled, they'd been randomized, they had been treated. For those patients, they were getting the assigned treatment, and they were following them up to get the essentially the life table estimates of the risk of a stroke. So the study was powered to detect 50% reduction in patients with high-grade stenosis, had a planned sample size of 600 in each of the two strata, and they were going to follow up patients for 5 years. The stopping rule, which I think is incredibly conservative, was that if they had a p-value of 0.001 demonstrating the superiority of one of the treatments, they didn't do anything. They waited for 6 months to see if it stayed there. So this is like, you know, you have, it has to be dead and smelling. And they had to be deemed unambiguous. I'm not sure how that would be unambiguous. And clinically important. I think stroke is a big deal. So this was in an era, this just represents the early 90s, where you needed like statistical, God herself had to come down and say, this is the answer before you're allowed to do anything. Okay. And there was a futility rule that allowed you to stop the study, but that isn't what we're going to talk about. So what the DSMB did by doing this ongoing monitoring of the trial data, accumulating experience after randomization, was realize, according to these rules, that after a third of the follow-up time, so 1.5 out of 5 years, they had met this stopping rule because they had access to the unblinded data and were able to stop the follow-up and issue a clinical alert that was circulated to physicians to communicate the benefits of NR regimen in this population. That does two things. The greater population, it allows physicians to know that maybe they should be referring the patients in this category to surgical therapy because there have been some unexplained variation in the use of this treatment in the population. The other thing it did is for the human subjects within the study who had been allocated to the medical treatment arm, it allowed them to know that maybe they now ought to find a really, really experienced vascular surgeon. Okay. Any questions on that? So that's early stopping for benefit. Wasn't stopping enrollment, it was stopping observation so that everybody can benefit from the early release development. The second example is a study of topiramate, which is an anti-seizure medication, in patients with ALS. And your language in your article says something about this study was done because there were no known effective treatments, which struck me as a government employee's way of saying there wasn't a good justification for this treatment. That's not what he said. So patients with ALS were randomized to topiramate versus placebo in this study, and the primary endpoint had to do with the rate of muscle strength deterioration over time. So you're trying to change the course of the disease. That's the primary endpoint. And because the population, we want to do everything we can to try to benefit them. There's tremendous need to try therapies, and I think some of these patients are quite motivated to try anything. The study was designed with both a randomized phase and then an open label continuation phase. So you randomize patients, you collect the data, and now while you're trying to sort out what's going on, and there's an open label extension where everybody can get the drug. And this is a way of trying to provide some potential benefit to patients who were initially randomized to placebo. You'll see some irony there in a second. At the end of the randomized phase, the DSMB noted that there was an excess of cases of thromboembolic disease, some DVTs, some pulmonary embolisms, and some patients with both DVTs and pulmonary embolism in the topiramate arm versus the placebo arm. Based on that, the DSMB said, well, there seems to be some risk associated with this, and they recommended termination of this open label extension. So these patients who were now sort of in good faith taking this experimental treatment while we were sorting out the primary endpoint. In fact, the analysis of the primary endpoint showed that there was more rapid loss of muscle strength in the active treatment arm relative to the placebo. Remember the bit about being in the placebo arm is good? Okay? So it's sort of interesting to me that the event that drove the early termination was the adverse event profile, which was not statistically significant, but that saved patients from continued exposure in the open label phase to a drug that appeared to be associated with more rapid decline of muscle strength. The next example, so the first example was early termination for benefit. The second one was early termination because of harm in an adverse event profile that actually turned out to correlate with protection from harm from the active treatment, or apparent harm from the active treatment. This next example is really related to two things, both oversight from the DSMB and the perils of subgroup analysis. So to set this up, this is a set of studies related to the use of antiplatelet agents for the patient's prevention of stroke in high-risk patients. So the first study, published in New England Journal in 1989, compared tyclopidine, which I gather is no longer on the U.S. market. I think Roche and everybody stopped making it. It was Tyclic, for those of us old enough to remember, versus aspirin. And they were looking at the three-year event rate for non-fatal stroke or death from any cause. And in this primary study, the rate of that endpoint was 17% for tyclopidine and 19% for aspirin. And tyclopidine was associated with some occasional severe side effects and had to be dosed twice daily as some other inconveniences. The first thing that I point out that the confidence interval they report for the difference goes from minus 2% to 26%, which somehow they translated to a p-value of 0.048, which is a statistical curiosity in my mind. Confidence interval crosses zero, p-value less than 0.05. It's remarkable. And then the conclusion here was that tyclopidine was somewhat more effective than aspirin in preventing strokes. This is when the New England Journal allowed you to take a negative result and have a positive conclusion at the end. Just saying. Okay. So then someone says, well, that didn't work. So what do you do when you do a really big study and you have a disappointing answer? You take a rest. Right? You go looking for something. So they did a subgroup analysis was done of the non-white patients. And I honestly don't know, all kidding aside, whether or not this was a specified subgroup analysis. I would suspect not, given the time, but I don't know that. And what they found in this planned or unplanned subgroup analysis was the one-year cumulative event rate. Notice we just went from 3 years to 1 year. That's another example of maybe you were digging around trying to find something. Was 5.5 per 100 patients for tyclopidine and 10.6 for aspirin for an apparent 48% reduction in the risk of stroke relative to aspirin. So this suddenly looked promising for the subgroup of non-white patients, if you're susceptible to this sort of thing. So what do we do when we identify a treatment effect in a non-pre-specified subgroup, changing the endpoint and digging around a little bit? We do a really big trial. Okay. So in this study, which was the follow-up to that, this was the randomized trial in just that subgroup. So the word non-white was replaced by black, which is more descriptive. And the DSMB in this case was looking at the futility and early stopping for benefit. So futility should be defined as the probability, if we continue the study to its end, that we will get an important answer. Maybe an important positive answer. It may be an important negative answer. There's things where you're comparing two treatments, both that are used in the community, where you actually want to prove that they are equivalent. Maybe they have different burdens, different costs, different availability to show that either is a viable option. Sometimes it's not important to show things are truly equivalent by completing a study to its end, because, for example, only one is currently approved. Okay. So in this case, what happened? Was that they were monitoring for futility, and after about 80% of the planned number of stroke events had been accumulated, the DSMB noted that there was less than a 1% chance that if they continued the observation, and the treatment and observation, that teclobamine would shown to be superior to aspirin, and a 50% chance that actually aspirin would be shown superior to teclobamine. Now, at that point, the DSMB is able to consider other things. Aspirin is inexpensive. It has a phenomenally good side effect profile. It's dosed once a day. Teclobamine is dosed twice a day and occasionally causes neurosuppression or platelet suppression. It has a side effect problem. It's also not generic at the time and much more expensive. So in that setting, if you have a treatment that you know is not going to be better and costs more, is harder to take, and has a worse side effect profile, you don't need to show for sure that the other treatment is preferred. You just need to rule out that the harder one isn't better. Didn't say that very clearly. But based on that, the DSMB recommended termination of the follow-up because they thought this was, they had answered the clinical question, which is we should give up on this drug and we should just give these patients aspirin. So in each of these cases, when the trial was designed, there was no way to predict what was going to happen. I tongue-in-cheek suggested that for the teclobamine, most statisticians who knew nothing about the disease probably could have predicted what was going to happen. But that's just because they've seen doctors do this over and over again, where we do it sometimes. Some groups get really excited to do a trial if they're sick of it. Okay. But in general, you really don't know what's going to happen, and that's why it's research. So you need to have processes in place, both in terms of the statistical design of the study, to take into the possibility that the treatment will be more effective than expected, even though that's quite rare. Similarly effective to how it's expected or actually cause harm, and the DSMB is put in place to implement those pre-specified stopping rules using unblinded data in a way that doesn't unblind those people conducting the study and might lead to bias in the way the study is conducted. And then the DSMB is also there to show judgment in applying information that's outside the statistical design of the study, like the judgment that aspirin is safe and cheap and easy to take, in deciding when a trial should be stopped prematurely. When they do their job well, this minimizes risks to human subjects, and it also minimizes the risk to the sponsor, because with an exception I'll mention in just a second, in most of the cases the sponsor does not want to continue to spend money on work that is unlikely to yield additional information that will benefit patients or the sponsor. The exception, ironically, I'm not a government employee, that's going to come up here in a second, is that when you get a five-year NIH grant, stopping a trial after 3 years because it's futile puts you in a real bind for the funding of your research group. And so there's an inherent conflict of interest between the interests of the PI and early termination. And that's something that for federally funded research or research funded through similar mechanisms really need to be cognizant of, because that incentive works counter to appropriate study management and in some cases protection of human subjects. Okay, I will stop there. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thanks, Robin and Roger both. So for some questions.
This is just a practical question. So it sounds like NINDS appoints a DSMB, but how do we initiate that, or how do we sort of select people and you guys approve, or how does that
work? So generally, NINDS will ask for a list of persons you feel might be impartial and fit the criteria, but we also have a list of our own, and we'll come up with a hybrid of people who will satisfy all the different positions. So nothing for you to worry about. It's initiated via us.
And just to add that, if anybody ever asks you to be on a DSMB, the answer should be yes. You will learn more about clinical trial conduct and quality by being on a DSMB and listening to the other people on the DSMB. It's as educational as being on a study section.
And actually, that's how I met Chris Coffey.
Okay, there are downsides.
Despite that one, I concur. Okay. So with those papers, you might have mentioned it had virtually every faculty room is often. want to address one thing you said about the Tamarian study, which is that although officially the decision to stop the open label component of that trial was based on the finding of thromboembolic events, the information about the faster progression with respect to strength occurred contemporaneously. So that information became available at the exact same meeting. So they chose to stop the trial. They made an announcement of why, but they could have just as well picked the other one. It wasn't that they were letting that one go while they waited for an adverse event.
So it's funny, last night about 1 a.m, I was wondering exactly that question, and I could not find that documented. I probably didn't know where to look. And it raises the general question about when a DSMB makes a recommendation, how much information do you give about the rationale for that recommendation? So when a DSMB recommends, as is most common, that a trial be continued as planned without modification, the norm is to give zero information regarding anything. Because if you're not asking them to do something different, you shouldn't give any information that would some way tip or even give people the perception that they know something about the interim data, the potentially unwind the so-called leakage of information. If you make a recommendation that a trial, a component of the trial, be stopped prematurely, it is only a recommendation. So in Robin's slide with the NINDS as the center of the universe, for-profit sponsors have similar perceptions. They usually don't put it as blatantly as you did. where they are the center of the universe and you are only recommending to them. So if you recommend a chain, you usually have to give information to justify that change. Now, if you're stopping the study and they choose to go along with it, the sponsors are in a very very interesting position. If they want to preserve the right, especially in an FDA-regulated study, to continue the study in contrast to your recommendation, they have to remain blinded. So once they're unblinded, the FDA says this study has no regulatory credibility. If they remain blinded, they can't look in detail about why you made the recommendation you did. So they're in a complete catch-22. So speaking from the point of view of the sponsors, they have to really trust their DSMB. Once they decide to go along with your recommendation, they can go look at everything. So in that setting, it would have been nice if it was clear that the DSMB had and was able to take into account both of those pieces of information. And I wonder, and maybe you can comment on this through personal knowledge, I wonder whether the reason it was the thromboembolic disease was pointed as the rationale was because the DSMB didn't want to preempt the release of the main study results.
I actually don't know that answer. I can't comment on that one. But the one other point I wanted to make about this, which is probably more generally relevant, is what the question is, well, the difference in strength was actually pretty big and apparent pretty early in the study. So why didn't they know about it earlier? And the answer is a problem that occurs in many academic studies, which is the clinical monitoring was done by an academic organization with limited resources. There was no planned interim analysis. So the data organized in that fashion really wasn't available until sometime after the entire study was finished and we were in the open label phase. So, it's much a manpower issue that other people in this room will face as well.
And probably the people who are trying to resource and plan for the conduct of the study, in their mind, couldn't fully comprehend the chance that it might cause harm. Because obviously, we don't do studies of disease of treatments that we think are likely to cause harm. And so we often don't consider that.
Chris? I wonder, this is related to the discussion with this paper, but one of the challenges that comes up after a study is done, particularly when it's stopped early with the DSMB, is even if the full rationale is discussed at the time with NINDS, the study team, it seldom comes through in the manuscript. And then there's this constant double guessing. There's a whole literature, right, that's developed from that. And I don't know, how do we get around that? Like, how do you get that out there? Because then, if from a DSMB, I think this feeds into an academic trial. The one new example you gave is 91. I still think there's a natural hesitancy on the DSMB side, not necessarily for the investigators with the 5-year grant, but DSMBs don't want to call it trial over, in academic trials. It's very different, I think, from industry DMCs over. So you wait till it's extremely, you know, it crosses. You're sure it's not going to go back over. I think you're naturally more conservative because they don't want to be second-guessed. I think there's this tendency not to be second-guessed because it doesn't come through in the manuscript. And everyone, you know, second-guesses why you have this whole literature. Well, what if they let this trial go? What would happen? I'm just curious what your thoughts are on that.
So there's multiple dimensions that I agree with all of the points. So the first is DSMB work is really not for the faint of heart because you sometimes have to make very difficult decisions with absolutely clearly inadequate information. I can give some personal examples. I would recommend the termination of a trial that led to closing of a nearly $1 billion Baxter research facility based on 57 patients. Did I second guess? Yeah, I got thrown out to talk to some people at Baxter. So you want to have a group in your DSMB that you're comfortable that as a group can make well thought out decisions that you will be happy to personally defend when necessary. The second point, which has to do with the rationale not getting out there, I think if you're involved in a DSMB that has a particularly difficult decision to make, that ultimately the DSMB should publish their experience. The tradition is not to have DSMB members as authors on primary manuscripts because then there's a conflict of interest because DSMB members have an inherent interest in the publishability of the primary trial. But it is perfectly reasonable for the DSMB at the end to write up a separate, frankly, relatively low-profile manuscript on why the DSMB did what it did after the primary results are published and to make those available. And in cases where the considerations were unusual or complex, I think there's a good reason to do that. There are journals, I think of Clinical Trials, which is an online journal, that are interested in this sort of thing. The barrier for publishing these things is lower because electronic publishing is so expensive, marginally expensive, so I would encourage that. The one thing that I think is interesting, and I will not go over, we're supposed to be done at 10 for a picture, I think.
Yeah, you're fine.
Okay. Is an interesting skepticism on the credibility of results from trials that are stopped prematurely. And there is there are true statistical issues about how you interpret data from experiments that are stopped prematurely. And then there's a much, much larger area of just paranoia, which has been fanned, unfortunately, by some colleagues north of the border. That don't understand the definition of bias. So in the setting when we're applying predefined early stopping criteria, an O'Brien Fleming rule, and you cross the boundary, it is relatively straightforward to figure out the magnitude of the bias and the estimate of the treatment effect associated with that stopping rule. And it is phenomenally small in the sense that it isn't going to change whether you think a result is positive. Remember, we're trying to figure out what the best treatment is. It really doesn't matter whether it's a 19.3% benefit versus an 18.9% benefit in terms of treatment choice. So I think there are minor statistical issues that can be well characterized when the rule is followed and pre-specified. When the DSMB, for some reason, causes a trial to be stopped in a way that is not pre-specified, it is very difficult to figure out what the effect is, and so the DSMB needs to be very cognizant of the potential adverse effects of that recommendation on the credibility of the trial results, and therefore the impact of the trial on subsequent clinical care. So as a DSMB chair, my role is to do everything I can to preserve the value of the trial to society. And if I do something that makes the trial non-credible, I'm not fulfilling that responsibility. The conservatism in academics, I think, is way, way overblown. You know, when people start a trial, they're, you know, in order just to be able to get up in the morning, I mean, my God, you guys work in neurology. In some of neurology diseases, you have 30 negative clinical trials in a row. It's pretty depressive. The most likely positive trial is a false positive at this point, in some areas. In order to get up in the morning, you have to fool yourself about the likelihood that the treatment's beneficial. And DSMB sort of buys into that, and they want so much for something to preserve, they tend to want it to be absolutely clearly, you know, dead and smelling before they kill it. But in terms of the efficiency of the overall research enterprise, this does a disservice to our sponsors, to our patients, and to ourselves. To the sponsors, because you ask for 2 additional years of funding from the agency that no longer answers a question that would have warranted the initial award. It's a disservice to the patients because they keep coming back to clinic visits or taking the medication, and in fact, the potential for benefit is markedly reduced compared to what they were told when they signed the consent form. I mean, right, you don't, on your 12th visit, study visit, you say, by the way, the interim data shows this stuff probably doesn't work, but I need 0.001 for another 6 months before I tell you that this is a waste of time. And that shows lack of respect for persons. And it's a disservice to society and to the academic community because the intellectual effort, the work of our personnel to continue that trial past when it has potential for substantial value detracts from our ability to take that research enterprise and focus it on the next most promising therapy in that area. So there's a real opportunity cost associated with hesitation. The difference in my mind between academics and industry in this setting is that industry has a clearer vision of that opportunity cost. You know, yes, they quantify it in dollars and net present value of assets, and that value system gives them greater credibility. In academics, working on a trial seems like more important professional work than having just finished your trial and trying to figure out what you're going to do. It feels like you're doing something, you're still running, okay? But the fact that you're running in place or running backwards, as long as you can fool yourself, you feel better about it. I think we have to get over that. We have to get comfortable with stopping trials early that would no longer pass the criteria for being continued in another setting. So, very long-winded answer, it's a great question. This really points out, as the gentleman in the back said, that having pre-specified rules and mechanisms in place to look for early harm, even when you think it's unexpected, is very, very important. Thank you very much.